Good evening, everyone. How are you doing? How was your day? Trust you had a wonderful time. Just work, school, family, trust all hasn't been so stressful. And trust you're having a wonderful evening. Yeah. Hope everyone can hear me on Mixlr. Can you all hear me on Mixlr? Can you? Okay, yeah. Thank you. All right. For those joining us for the first time, you're actually welcome to Beloved City Church Bible Study. My name is Damilola, the lead pastor of Beloved City, Damilola Dada, and I'm pleased to meet you and I welcome you. Just join us for the first time, you can click the subscribe button. You're actually welcome to tonight's Bible study. So, for the past 3 weeks, we've actually been looking at God and business. First time, we look at God and business itself. Second time, we look at tithing, savings and investments, the life of Joseph. Now, we're about to look at finances, the life of Solomon. That's what we're about to look at tonight. And I trust God you're going to be blessed. I can be so sure of that. So, alright, let's pray first of all. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for tonight's Bible study. Thank you for wisdom. Thank you for clarity. Thank you for equipping us with knowledge. Thank you because you are rewarding our steps. Thank you because you are erasing our past errors and mistakes and flooding us with fresh light. You should be the exalted in Jesus' name. As we press into the word, we pray that access is granted by the Spirit and insight is given in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Alright, so we want to look at a very crucial man in the scriptures, which is the person of Solomon. Ah, Solomon. Solomon, 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 Solomon. If there's anything Christ compares Solomon to, was his glory in terms of dressing compared to the lilies of the field, and said if God clothed them more. He said even Solomon could not be compared to how God created the lilies of the field and the oil. But we saw something crucial about this man was that this man was a picture that God could actually bless the man. I think in the scripture so far, we can see that aside Christ, Solomon was like the richest figure we could see. Everything about him was practically money. If I want to put it like that, his cup was good. His spoon was good. Some of you listening to me, Solomon's spoon can buy your apartment. So it's very funny. Solomon's phone can buy his phone can buy the iPhone you are using now, because I'm sure the kind of gold he had this time was good gold. Yes, Solomon's mansion can buy, if possible, a state, because it was practically in what they call money. It was practically like that. But there was something beyond that I want us to see concerning finances, which is very crucial in the life of Solomon. So let's look at firstly how Solomon was and his life. Okay. So before I even proceed further, there were certain things you notice about Solomon. Solomon prayed to God. He said, God, give me wisdom to rule thy people. Now, out of the wisdom of Solomon, three crucial things flowed forth in his time. There was peace, there was influence, and there was finances. So there was wisdom for peace. But before Solomon's time, people were always fighting against the Philistines and the Egyptians. But by wisdom, they submitted to Solomon. And by that, peace actually came in. And by that, Solomon's influence grew that all the kings knew Solomon. You know, a woman had to travel down, the queen of Sheba. She traveled down because his fame spread abroad. So Solomon, as a result of wisdom, was able to balance peace in the environment. As a result of wisdom, was able to work in influence. And as a result of wisdom, the third part was able to work in strange financial prosperity. So we see that wisdom is key for peace. Wisdom is key. That's why I go into the New Testament and say the wisdom of God is pure and not less, it is peaceful. So wisdom is key for peace. Wisdom is key for influence. So we see that when you are arising, influence is coming out. Influence is coming out. Wisdom is actually key to sustain that level. Then we saw the third dimension was that wisdom was key for the finances of Solomon. So just like I touched last week, I talked to Joseph as a platform, as a portal for wisdom, or a life of wisdom, or a principle for wisdom. And now another person we are seeing for wisdom is the person of Solomon. But today our capture is not to look at the peaceful dimension in walking in peace with your enemies and not to let them submit it to you. Because if we look at the New Testament, the dimension of God that is going to crush Satan and crush all the enemies in the last days, Paul called it the God of peace. He said the God of peace shall surely conquer Satan underneath your feet. So peace is a platform to overcome the enemy. So beyond just peace, you saw the part of influence. Another person beyond Solomon that also had influence in the New Testament was Jesus. The Bible said that his fame spread abroad. The Bible said when he entered the city actually shook. So we see that wisdom is crucial for peace. Wisdom is crucial for influence. Someone talks about influence a lot. And the third aspect is wisdom is crucial for finances. So let's look at Solomon and finances. 1 Kings 22, chapter 4, verse 22 to 23. 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 22 to 23. 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 22 to 23. And it says, I think before that, let's look at that. Okay. It says, verse 22 to 23. I want us to look at the Message translation. And I read. It says, one day's food supply for Solomon's household was 185 bushels of fine flour, 375 bushels of meal, 10 grain-fed cattle, 20 rich cattle, 100 sheep, and miscellaneous deer, gazelles, roebucks, and choice fowl. Now, when you look at that scripture, it didn't say 1 week provision of Solomon. It didn't say 1 year. It said one day. So in one day, Solomon was eating 100 sheep, if it was possible. Solomon was having choice of fowl. Solomon had 20 cattle. Solomon had 10 grain-fed cattle. Solomon had 375 or so. It was not time. It's like saying he had 375 bag of rice. And then he had 100 goats. And he had different kind of chickens that were moving about. Now, the thing is, all these things were coming every single day for Solomon. So even his food, Solomon is a picture of what the Lord called, you shall eat in plenty and be satisfied. Living in that moment, I don't know how you ought to fast anyway, but whatever Solomon was living, what you call, you know, provision is diverse from there. So they call provision as finance. They saw they saw provision as food. And they saw they call provision in materials. Solomon, in terms of food, was fully satisfied beyond measure. That was one. Now let's look at money aspect of Solomon. It's another dimension. 2 Chronicles chapter 1 verse 15. 2 Chronicles chapter 1 verse 15. Oh, okay. I'll read the Message translation. He said, the king made silver and gold as common as rock. You want that? Now let me read KJV. What KJV is saying? Verse 15. And the king made silver and gold at Jerusalem as plenteous as stone. You know what stone is? Stone is actually stone. It means if you go on the road, normally what you walk on the road, you can't walk in the street without seeing stones, not a stone. There are stones always on the ground. So the Bible says Solomon made it like that to that extent. So let's say if I was walking in Jerusalem, you could just see gold everywhere. Everything practically in Solomon's time was good. Another translation said, everything he had as vessels, nothing was called silver. Everything was good. That was another part in the scripture. Everything was good. So in the real sense, Solomon made money to a measure that really it cannot be quantified. Because you cannot really quantify stones. Stones are plenty all over the nations. So the way Solomon finances works, what we are calling boundaries cannot be called to those finances. His finances cannot really be quantified. He had both quality and in quantity. That was how Solomon finances was. He had it in terms of food and he had it in terms of money. But now there's something that now saw that is money. You know, it's one thing if you have money and you should be ignorant of what to use money for. Solomon, as a result of wisdom, channeled his money to building structures. Solomon, as a result of wisdom, channeled his money to building and creating shields, creating courts. So, despite he has money, Solomon shows us a picture of creativity in what to use money for. So there are some people that have money, but they don't know what to use money for. They begin to ask questions. Should I invest in the money? Should I buy this? Should I buy a land? Should I buy a car? Should I buy this? Should I buy that? But so now in Solomon's time, there was not just money. There was creativity in what to use gold and silver for. And it's a scripture. When you look at the life of Bezalel and Aholiab, God said they are craftsmen to work in gold and in silver and precious stones. So meaning when Bezalel looks at money, creativity comes in what to use money for. You can see money and you can see like 10 different things that you can use money for. If you see money, Solomon can begin to see that one, I can start a shop. Two, I can build an organization. Three, I can build real estate, which was what he did. He started building structures beyond the work of God. Built for his wife, built in the city, built the temple. So he started building structures and structures and structures and structures. You know, when I say picture of the kind of temple of Solomon, it was actually made of gold. You know, in Moses' time, what he called the cherubims are dangerous to a small boy. Solomon, they were giants, and everything was practically good. So he was having creativity in what you use money for. So I'm saying that one dimension you can come to the level of Solomon is that when you have money, creativity in what to specifically use money for. So there are some of us that have money that you can use money and fine-tune it in investment. There are some that have money, you can fine-tune it in starting up a business. Something that also yield returns back to you. So that's just one dimension of it. So we're saying that Solomon was having supply in terms of food. So we can work with God to a point that there is supply for our daily life. I was saying something last week that it was a God that fed Egypt and the Israelites, the Israelites for complete 40 years, not just in manna. He fed them in meat. That's why we had what they call quails coming. The quails were coming, and those quails stayed. Even when you study the scripture, the Bible said their height was as 2 cubits. It's different from how many were there. Meaning, if you had to see those quails, they had a level of height in terms of tallness that were filling the entire. So, God is a God that if you walk with Him, supernatural provision is actually possible. And by Solomon, God was not blessing Solomon like that. Solomon was able to access it in the dimension of the wisdom of God. Because God said, I'll give you wisdom. Then in that, I also multiply unto you riches and honor like no other king ever existed. So that's just one thing. So another thing I also want to touch about Solomon in 1 Kings chapter 5, verse 5 to 6. 1 Kings chapter 5, verse 5 to 6. Okay. And it says there, he was speaking concerning Hiram. And said, and build, I propose to build an house unto the name of the Lord my God. As the Lord spake unto David my father, saying, thy son, whom I will set upon thy throne, he shall build an house unto my name. Now therefore, command thou that he give me cedar trees out of Lebanon, and thy servant will be my servant. And to thee I will give hire for thy servant according to all thou shalt appoint. For thou knowest that there is not among us as that can ski to you timber like unto the Siberians. Now let me look to read the message. Translation. Alright. This is what Solomon said. And here is how you can help. Give orders for cedars to be cut from the Lebanon forest. My loggers will walk alongside yours, and I will pay men whatever wage you set. Only a rich man can talk. If you call it a rich man, a wealthy man can talk like that. Solomon did not say that. Can I agree for the price? He said, Hiram should set any amount, he will pay it. He now said, we both know that there is no one like you see Jesus for cutting grass. So meaning, another thing Solomon kept money was that Solomon was able to pay for the skill of people whatsoever he was trying to do. So you are starting up a business, that you can use money for, is to pay for professional skill. You know, Pastor David was talking one time in ICPMLW, and he was talking to ministers and to pastors. He said there are times that when you are coming for an orientation, you are coming, you need something in your church, you need something in your organization, whatever the case may be. He said you must learn to pay for professionals if it has to take you to do that. So we saw that for Solomon, Solomon was paying for high quality skill. Why? Because he was not just having money. That's why I said he had money, but he had creativity in what to use money for. One thing he used money for was to build structures. Are you getting my point? So he had land, he built structure. Another thing he used money for, again, was to actually buy the skill of people, professionals. Are you getting my point? So if you got professional skill, whatever they built, if Solomon is also to translate that into money, he's going to yield a greater return. So this king was not just a king that was rich. He was a king that had wisdom and creativity in what to use money for. That's why you go to the book of Ephesians chapter 1 verse 17. When talking about wisdom, the word translation there means insight. So meaning, when I hold on to, when something is given to me, I can look at it and I can see diverse kind of things to do with it. So that's why some people can just look at, let's say for example, you have a cloth and the cloth is, you feel it is gone. Someone else can just look at the cloth and see different things to do with it. I was watching one time when I was much more, and I saw how people were using plastic bottles to build things. And I was like, this is the same plastic bottle that we throw on the road. That said that nothing is really useless. So when we have the spirit of wisdom and there is money, there will be creativity you want to use money for. So many of us now that we're having money now and we don't know what to do, we don't know whether to invest, we don't know whether to buy it, we don't know whether to start a business, we don't know whether to trade, we don't know what to do with the money. It shows one dimension that is lacking is the spirit of wisdom. The way Solomon made use of money and resources and things was not necessarily the same way Joseph did it. So based on what I want to use money for, it cannot be void of a work with God. So God gives us insight specifically how to channel money, how to what to use money for, how to be creative about our wealth and so many other things like that. So another thing I want to talk about Solomon, let's look at the giving life of Solomon, because it's one thing for Solomon to be rich, it's another thing for Solomon to come into wealth. I want to look at what was the certain things that prompted these kind of things that prompted the results Solomon was having financially. All right, let's look at 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 63. I'll just mention certain things. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 63. 1 Kings 18, verse 63. Okay. Sorry, 1 Kings 18. Okay, sorry, 1 Kings 8, verse 63. 1 Kings 8, verse 63. Okay. All right. And it says here, the king and all Israel with him then worshipped, and he was offering sacrifices to God. Solomon offered peace offering, sacrificing to God 22,000 cattle and 120 sheep. This is how the king and all Israel dedicated to God. Now, if you want to be as rich as Solomon, you must come to the giving life of Solomon. Solomon, in his kind of giving, was closely given to what they call a giving without measure. That's why I used to say something. Somebody that cannot give 50 naira should not expect 50,000 from God. Somebody that cannot give 500 should not be thinking God will just give you 1 million like that. Because why? In scripture, there's what they call a law or principle of sowing and reaping. So when it comes to the kingdom of God, what they call giving beyond your, what they call giving beyond measures is also crucial. How you give, that's why just like I said, in the manner which you give, say, men shall also give back to you in return. So we saw that Solomon was not just a king that God blessed. He was a king that gave God also his best. He gave God almost enough. He was just, because I can't see why he's always someone keep close to 20,000 caps just for you to say, I want to give this as a dedication to God on the structure I have used for the Lord. So after that, the Bible said God appeared the second time to Solomon in Gibeon. Kai. And God began to speak. God began to say, this is what I'm going to do to you. This is what I'm going to do to you. So Solomon did not just enter wealth overnight. Solomon paid some sacrifices that gave activation or access to the wealth of Solomon. So you see, take for example, the person of Solomon, I was in, okay, let me mention the name. There was a particular man of God. I have already mentioned the name. God has to tell him, clear the account of your ministry and carry it to Winner's Chapel and go and sow. And he sold it. And when he came back, he fell flat on God and he spoke to God. That ended poverty in his life completely. So there are times that when God comes, God asks for your very best. So when I hear testimony of great men of God, how they clear their accounts year by year. The one that really scattered one time was when I heard that, that everybody gave out 100 cars in redeem. Hey, they brought 100 cars to him. You know, if it was someone, another person, that person could think of, let me go and start a car business. We just called people out. You know, you don't have a car, come out. And he said, from today, you are a car owner. And he gave out 100 cars. For a person to do that, he has come to a place that you understand that God is his source in supply. Are you getting the point? He's someone that has given God his best. So why is he not buying jets? You don't have a reason to complain. They had paid prices for God to bless them. So that's just the truth part about the scripture. So the same way, when the queen of Sheba came, the Bible said when she saw the gold in Solomon's place, the Bible said the spirit in her was gone. Now let's look at that just one. So I seen one of the platform of Solomon was that Solomon obtained a principle of giving to God's kingdom. That's the first principle of access to Solomon, understanding God. Now another dimension I want to touch is finances for the nation. Let's look at 1 Kings chapter 4. Verse 25 and then 20 to 1. 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 25 and 20 to 1. 1 Kings 4, verse 25. Okay, sorry, 1 Kings chapter 4. Okay. Verse 25. Okay, let me start from verse 20 to 1. Then I'll go to verse 25. Judah and Israel were densely populated, like sand on an ocean beach. And with the message translation, all their needs were met. They ate and drank and were happy. That's one. Now, let's go to verse 25. Okay. Solomon, okay, it says, throughout Solomon's life, everyone in Israel and Judah lived safe and sound. All of them from Dan into the north of Bathsheba the south pointed to God. So one, the first aspect was like Solomon in the nation, because he existed, the people too did not lack any form of food. They overate. Then when he now got to Solomon's time again, financially the people did not lack. So it was a king that not just go to God's kingdom, he gave to his community and the nation. So meaning beyond just giving to the church, there must be a part of giving to the people outside, giving to the poor. That's why you see in scripture saying that when you don't give to the poor, God will not hear you. So there's a principle of sowing to God's kingdom. There's another principle Solomon followed, which is giving to the people outside. You see someone lacking food, you see someone not having, you give. And there's a principle in the New Testament. John was saying that you see your brother does not have food and it's coming to you. Don't just say God bless you, give to the blessing. So we saw that Solomon was someone that gave to God, someone was someone that gave to people. Now there's another third dimension which I don't want to touch, which I will now use to post this message. Okay, First Kings chapter 4, verse 26 to 28. He says, Solomon had 40,000 stores for chariot horses and 12,000 horses. The district manager, each according to his assignment, delivered food supply for the Solomon. And he says, and all who sat at the king's table, there was always plenty. Can you hear that? So meaning the third aspect was Solomon made sure that his own household did not lack. That's why you see in scripture, Jesus was firing some people. He said, some of you say you want to give unto God, but you say you cannot give to your parents. He said they will call it a korban that cannot give for my parents. It's actually a gift unto God. So Jesus said on firing with disciples. So we are seeing three different levels of the giving of Solomon. Solomon gave without measure to God's kingdom. Solomon gave to his community to the point that they were satisfied. And three, Solomon gave to his own household. That's why I see scripture talking about a man providing for his own household. So we are seeing that in this three dimension, giving is crucial. That's why I see some people, they learn to honor their parents financially. There's a place where they call the blessings of the parents. Example is the case we see in the place of Isaac, Jacob, and Esau. He honored his father, and his father prayed for him. It was a prayer that is fasting and prayer in the next 5 years will not have gotten him. Are you getting my point? So we are seeing that there are certain things that cause access to finances. Giving to God's kingdom without measure, giving to the poor, to the nations, to the point that everybody will not lack. Then the third dimension is giving to your own household. So let me just pause on this for tonight. I believe you have been blessed, and I trust that you have actually learned. So let's just pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for everyone that listened. I pray that their finances are blessed. I pray that they are blessed beyond measure. I pray for financial provision. I pray for food provision. And I pray for material provision in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, you want to give your tithes, your offering, or you want to sow into our Union 2021 program that is actually coming. Okay? This is the account number below CCT UBA 210-579-7641. 210-579-7641. All right, so our fasting starts tomorrow at the church. Thursday, Friday, Saturday. We break 6 p.m. every day, not necessarily food. The pattern of the fast, I believe they will be sent in the announcement, and they have been set all the entire group chat platforms and all. So make sure you engage in the fast. Make sure you try to do it faithfully. So there will be prayer chat. So if you want to get more info, our WhatsApp link will be sent. You can chat. Okay, sorry. You want to get more info? Chat up from your joy. Their numbers are added to our WhatsApp platform. You want to join the discipleship class? Also chat up Fumi and John. Alright, so you know, and the fasting is towards Union 2021, which is coming up May 29th. So you like to register also. You see the link of the Union program there, or you chat the following number we actually mentioned. So you can come with your spouse, your fiancé, register and for you and them, and we'll save a seat for you while you actually come. So you want to sow financially into Union, like I said, I've mentioned the account number, Velocity UBA 210-579-7641 UBA. Let me pray for us, Father, to as many sowing towards Union 2021, to as many also giving their tithes, and some that are giving their offerings, I pray you multiply their finances, you multiply their seeds in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. For Sunday service actually continues. We actually meet on Sunday to also gather for prayers, and it's very, very crucial. So this particular Sunday, we'll be looking at courtship. So we'll be expecting you to actually come around, come and let us know about relationship. Every one of us is going to get married. We're going to be fathers. We're going to give out the children. We're going to be mothers. We're going to give out the children. So those things are very, very crucial. All right. So just follow our social media. On Instagram, it is Velocity Community. On Facebook, it is Velocity. On Telegram, it is also actually Velocity. All right. Thank you so much. I believe you're blessed. I love you guys. Don't forget to subscribe and see you again. God bless you. Love you. Good night.